Listening Library presents Vampiric Vacation by Kiersten White. Read for you by Keylor, Leigh. For all the kids who can't stop fidgeting. Same. Come sit by me. Alexander unlocked Will's door, and they crept inside. The drapes were pulled tightly, the entire space as dim as a haunted graveyard at twilight. Will was cocooned in her blankets, not even her face visible.
"You do the drapes, I'll garlic her," Theo whispered. "Are we sure about this?"
Alexander had never considered what it might take to save a teenage sister from undead existence. Were they making the right choice?
"It has to be done,"
Theo said, her voice solemn but determined. No evil vampires were taking her sister away.
"We do it on the count of three."
Alexander nodded. He took the drapes firmly in hand, watching over his shoulder.
"One?"
Theo unscrewed the lid to the garlic salt.
"Two?"
Alexander whispered, bracing himself, as though he were at the start of a race and didn't know what the finish line would bring.
"Three!"
Alexander flung open the drapes. Will sat up, the blankets falling away from her face as she blinked bleary red eyes at them.
"Yeah!"
Theo shouted, and threw the whole bottle of garlic salt. Will screamed, clawing at her face. Had they just saved their sister? Or destroyed her? Chapter 1. The day was decidedly sinister, but not in a charming, sinister Winterbottom way. If it was a sinister Winterbottom way, it might be a day that puttered around the yard, building battle robots with built-in cookie ovens, like Mr. Sinister Winterbottom. Or it might be a day that painted wild murals of storm-tossed seas populated with tentacled friends, while its cookies baked in the battle robot oven, like Ms. Sinister Winterbottom. Or it might be a day with its nose against a phone screen while a frown creased its impressively expressive black eyebrows, like Wilhelmina Sinister Winterbottom. Or it might be a day that ran at full speed, the wind whipping its hair, grass lashing its bare shins, screaming joy and delight and something close to anger, like Theodora Sinister Winterbottom. Or it might be a day that gazed pensively out the car window at the blurring landscape, wondering what it was heading toward and what might possibly go wrong there, because it couldn't imagine that everything would just be fun and pleasant and nothing would go wrong, like Alexander Sinister Winterbottom. Well, on second thought, this day was rather like Alexander Sinister Winterbottom. Heavy clouds pressed down on the atmosphere, looming closer than clouds ought to loom, as though they were worried about the day too, and couldn't keep it to themselves. They scooted closer and closer to the earth, peering down at the massive aqua car drifting at alarming speed down a lonely road.
"Pretty dark for noon,"
Alexander said, unable to swallow the tight lump of worry stuck in his throat. He loved storms, from his own house, curled up on the window seat, with a mug of hot cocoa and a good book, and his mother humming somewhere deep under the house while his father scrambled to get all the battle robots into the garage. But he didn't have his window seat, or hot cocoa, or a good book, or his parents. And he still didn't know why he and his siblings had been banished to spend the summer with their mysterious Aunt Sophronia. Theo repeatedly bonked her head against the cold glass of the car window, like the world's worst drum. She hated long car rides. She couldn't read without getting sick, so she usually listened to an audiobook. But there was no stereo, just a weird old radio you had to adjust by twisting knobs. Aunt Sophronia seemed happy to keep the knobs between stations. The maddening white noise of static filled the car. Every once in a while, Theo could swear she heard voices whispering in the static, just barely too quiet to understand. Which made her mad, because there was already so much she didn't understand right now. Why had their parents woken them in the middle of the night and dumped them on Aunt Sophronia a week ago? Why hadn't their parents at least called since then? Why did she feel both angry and sad at the same time, when she didn't want to feel either? And why did these big feelings make her buzz like she was filled with a hive of angry bees? Holding her head against the window made her skull vibrate and her teeth chatter. It was as close as she could get to moving while stuck in a car, so she pressed her forehead harder against the glass. This drive seemed like it had lasted forever. Had they even gone back to Aunt Sophronia's house after leaving Fathoms of Fun Water Park? Theo glanced at Alexander. He wasn't in his swimsuit, and they were both totally dry. They must have gone back to their aunt's house, showered, and changed. But Theo couldn't remember doing any of that. They had been in the car at Fathoms of Fun, and now they were in the car going somewhere else, and her brain couldn't connect the dots about what had happened between. "Weird," she muttered, bonking her head once more against the window. Alexander didn't need to know what Theo thought was weird. Everything was weird, and he didn't like it. And his stomach hurt with all the not liking he was doing regarding all the weird they were experiencing. In the passenger seat, Will, age 16, and therefore 4 years older than twins Alexander and Theo, and therefore permanently claiming shotgun in the unfair way older siblings always do, as though a few extra years on Earth put them first in line for everything, forever, paused her frantic typing on her phone when a message popped up. "Edgar," she said, a dreamy smile breaking the intensely focused expression on her face. "Edgar?" Alexander and Theo said at the same time, perking up. Edgar was a lifeguard at the water park they had just left after a week of fun. Well, after 2 days of fun. Before the 2 days of fun were several days of wily widows, menacing mustaches, terrifying tunnels, and lingering in libraries. Most of their time at Fathoms of Fun had been rather stressful and occasionally scary, thanks to an evil fraternal twin and her henchmen. But it ended on a rush of reuniting the real widows and restoring the park to its gothic glory. And since it all ended happily, the three sinister Winterbottoms only felt happy when they thought of it. Of course, Will felt a little more than happy when Edgar texted her. And who could say what Aunt Sophronia felt? Her face was still oddly indistinct, as though seen through several panes of thick glass. Her gaze never seemed to focus on what was around her, except for right now, as she turned and stared at the antique brass stopwatch Theo still wore around her neck. Alexander said. "Aunt Sophronia?" Theo added. "You should be watching the road," Will said, which was sharp criticism coming from a girl who never looked up from her phone. "I should?" Aunt Sophronia tilted her head, her long black hair moving in slow motion, as though she were trapped underwater. Theo had a strange moment of wondering if Aunt Sophronia really did need to watch the road, though. The car was still going perfectly straight, as though it was steering itself. But that was impossible. A car so old that it didn't even have a good stereo certainly couldn't have a self-driving option, could it?
"Please keep your eyes on the road," Alexander squeaked, 100
different ways the car could crash all crashing through his head. Aunt Sophronia laughed, a sound like wind chimes. Not tinkling, bright metal wind chimes, but old chimes made of wood. So they just sort of brushed and clacked against each other.
"Silly boy," she said. "If my eyes were on the road, that would really scare you. I'll keep them in my head."
Then she paused, turning ever so slowly to look straight out the windshield.
"Unless children like that sort of thing?"
Alexander and Theo exchanged a baffled look. Though they were twins, they were hardly mirror images. Theo had brown hair, cut short so she wouldn't have to worry about brushing it.
It was pushed back from her forehead by a headband that made it stick up wildly, rather hedgehog-like in appearance. Alexander's hair was also cut very short, but not so short that he didn't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.